tonight. A request backed by the city for the expansion of the overflowing DP Todd Secondary School has been denied by the province. Plus, the city has been denied of opting out of new legislation surrounding short-term rentals. And we speak with a criminologist about the recent crime trends in Prince George. Good evening, I'm Eddie Huband, and welcome to CKPG News. We begin tonight with education news. Back in September of 2023, Prince George City Council had a meeting with the Minister of Education, Rashna Singh, at the Union of BC Municipalities Conference in Vancouver. That meeting was to discuss priorities for Prince George and School District 57, including the expansion of DP Todd Secondary School. And the minister recently wrote a letter to council regarding the meeting, but it's not the news the city or the school was hoping for. Adam Burrows has tonight's top story.
DP Todd Secondary School was built back in 1978, and since then, the student population has grown substantially. For years, the school district and the city have tried to get the province to provide funding for an expansion for DP Todd, but to no avail. In a recent letter to City Council, the Minister of Education, Rakhna Singh, did not commit to any new funding for DP Todd, but Councillor Ron Palillo is hoping that could still change.
I really think, hopefully with an election year, that we'll hear finally a funding announcement for a minimum a renovation, but what should be a total rebuild for DP Todd.
For the 2023-24 school year, DP Todd saw the addition of 42 new students, bringing the total number of students to 820, far over capacity.
It's a school built for just over 600, and we have this bubble of kids coming through now. And that enrollment challenge is going to be even more acute over the next 2 to 3 years. So the time is now to get this school built.
The current solution to the ongoing capacity issues has been to install portables on the grounds, which now total 6. But the ministry does not pay for portables, the school district does. And it is evident that the portables will not fix the root problem.
They may add another portable to deal with this bubble coming through, which would make 7. I mean, how many portables do we need to put on to make a compelling case to the ministry and the government that it's time now to give us more capacity and build a brand new school?
Palillo says that the city is hoping to work more with the school district on advocating for expansion.
We're shooting for, you know, 2 to 3 times, 4 times a year to meet, to talk about these common issues, because there are a lot of common issues between what SD 57 does and the city of Prince George. So they're fully aware of what we're trying to do.
In the capital submission to the ministry, it is estimated that a full school replacement would cost roughly $102 million, and an expansion or renovation would cost roughly $66.5 million. Adam Burrows, CKPG News.
Disappointment keeps rolling in for City Council. The Housing Ministry has rejected the city's bid to opt out of a piece of legislation surrounding short-term rentals. That because the city fell just shy of the opt-out qualifications. But some councillors haven't given up just yet. Cheryl Jan has the story.
Housing has been a bane for the province for years. It's the rationale behind the Short-Term Rental Accommodation Act, which restricts short-term rentals such as Airbnbs. But City Council made the case to opt out of the restrictions.
Sometimes I think any level of government, I'll give the benefit of the doubt there, but the provincial government almost tries to use a cookie-cutter approach that this one size will fit all for the province. And sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. In this case, I don't think it fits the bill. I think Prince George is unique compared to a Tofino or a Kelowna or a Victoria, where the tourism is just very different in those places than here.
The province set a benchmark of vacancy rates for a community to opt out of the restrictions, 3% in each of 2 consecutive years. According to Canada Mortgage and Housing, Prince George's vacancy rate was 3.7% in 2022 and 2.8% last year. As such, the Ministry of Housing rejected Prince George's bid, saying data does not meet the criteria to enable the city to request an exemption.
Yeah, it's a disappointing for the local industry because we as council realize our industry is slightly different. It's not really geared for tourism as much as for the people, medical professionals, and the people working in the various mines. Requires a long-term, but yet short-term kind of rental for a few months at a time.
Of course, our door is always open. If the schedules permit, I'd be happy to meet with mayor and council and whoever comes part of their delegation.
The other factor is that when government disallows something, it drives it underground.
It's very difficult to enforce it in terms of going to people, the private properties, and see what's going on. There's a different way to do it. I mean, you know, the implementation, it's not really our job.
And some members of council are going to hold the Minister of Housing to that open door.
We're actually going down to Victoria to advocate for a number of different things for our community. And if we can add this to the list and have a meeting with Minister Callan, I think that'd be beneficial, so we can explain our side a little bit more in depth and give him a chance to understand where we're coming from and why we would like Prince George to be opted out of this legislation change.
The plan is to head to Victoria next month. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
A recent poll has come out painting an interesting new picture in the BC political landscape. Adam Burles joins us now to break it all down. So, Adam, this poll has been very positive for the BC Conservative Party. In fact, they are creeping up in the polls in a major, major way. First of all, can you just talk about the numbers, and will this trend hold come October when there's a provincial election?
Right. So John Rastad is very happy with this recent new poll from Main Street Research. Current numbers have the NDP government still in the lead at 39.6%, but the Conservatives have creeped up quite close to the governing NDP at 34.2%. That's quite a jump from any other polls that we have seen. The NDP has had quite a healthy lead over a Conservative BC United, usually by 10, 15 points. This one has them only within about 5-6. So it's very good news for the BC Conservative Party. Now, again, we should mention that these are polls and that polls are not infallible. We did see that. There's a famous example, 2013, 2012 BC election, where NDP was projected to win quite handily with the poll numbers having them way in the lead, but the Liberals won that election under Christy Clark. So things can still change. Could this hold lead until October when the election is scheduled to be called? Who knows? Polls seem to be very good for the Conservatives right now. It's all going to be based on dynamics of what happens, what announcements the government makes, what announcements the NDP, the Conservatives will make in the next coming months. That will really determine the pace of how polling numbers will happen.
And, you know, it's interesting you said that because, I mean, to me, this could be linked to, the traction that the federal Conservative Party has right now across the country. Do you think that those two things are related?
There is certainly some evidence that that could be the case. I mean, when it comes to, I'll take the carbon tax increase that's going to be happening on April 1st. John Rusted has
spoken out against
the carbon tax, so has Pierre Poilievre. But the BC Conservatives have been cleverly linking themselves to some federal Conservative statements, announcements. So by linking themselves with the federal party, which is doing very well federally and quite popular over the governing Trudeau Liberals, there is some correlation there. Of course, correlation doesn't equal causation, but if you were just to look at the basic two numbers, you could say that there is definitely a link there. But John Rustad's being clever by linking himself with the federal Conservatives, so that could be helping him.
So all this is not great news for Kevin Falcon and the BC United Party.
No.
Now, I wanted to speak about sort of how this breaks down regionally. What's it looking like if you look at BC broken down?
So, no surprise, NDP holds the lead in Metro Vancouver, Vancouver Island. BC Conservatives are maintaining that lead in the interior. Now, it is a bit of a surprise because BC United for many, many years has been the stronghold of the interior. The interior has been their stronghold.
Right.
So to see that flip to BC Conservatives is certainly striking because that means they're getting a lot of traction in the interior. John Rustad, of course, MLA for Nechako Lakes, just west of us here in Prince George. So by getting that traction in the interior, he can take those seats away from the BC United Party in the election and leave them high and dry.
And how are things playing out in the north, just quickly?
North, things are still playing out in the north. It's going to be hard to tell. I mean, John Rustad, obviously, northern politician, northern BC, so he's got a lot of strength up here as well. BC United, still, it's hard to tell. We have veterans like Shirley Bond up here who's still very popular, but it's going to be interesting when it comes to election time. Mike Morris is retiring. Got two new candidates in Rachel Weber for the Conservatives and Kyle Giddens, BC United. Two unfamiliar faces when it comes to the provincial political scene. Two new faces. It could be a toss-up of where this riding will go. So veterans will probably do
pretty well. Can't tell yet, but John Rustad, BC Interior seems to be a stronghold, and the North could be that way too.
All right, Adam Burles, thank you very much. Things are certainly heating up on the political landscape. Adam, thank you for your insight, as always. And the provincial government is warning about a scam involving a fake version of its PayBC website being used to steal personal and credit card information. The legitimate PayBC website gives residents a place to pay their bills for government services. The government says the fake site looks nearly the same, except website addresses are different. It's warning people be vigilant against such phishing attempts and to make sure that they're in the proper pay.gov.bc.ca website address. Well, it's no secret, it's been a busy year for local RCMP, as crime has seen an uptick in the first few months of 2024. Tommy Osborne spoke to a well-known crime expert from the Lower Mainland to weigh in on the increase in crime in Prince George and the causes behind it, and tells us now more on how Lower Mainland gang behavior impacts the North.
Since the new year, Prince George has been no stranger to crime, as we've seen four homicides, an armed carjacking, armed robbery, and more. But what's behind this increase? One criminologist from the Lower Mainland confirms what our RCMP has known for a while, that gangs from the Lower Mainland are moving up north to take advantage of an active drug market.
It's a very young population, very wealthy, making a lot of money, and they're a transient population, so they don't worry too much about what's happening around them. So they will spend their surplus incomes on entertainment.
But why does Prince George specifically have such a large market for drugs? Gordon explained one big factor is that we have a lot of people here that aren't permanent residents. For example, workers here just for a temporary job. They have the money and they're not staying. On top of that, both Gordon and the RCMP added that unlike southern BC, which is quite densely populated, Prince George's relative isolation also plays a big role.
We're a hub, so it brings in a lot of issues from across the region that you just don't see in these other communities. So in the Okanagan, you have several larger communities. You have Kamloops, you have Kelowna, even a little smaller Vernon, Penticton, but they're all within an hour of each other. So they somewhat share the burden as opposed to us being up here in the north where we're 6 hours from the nearest similar size center.
The federal government legalizing marijuana has made it far safer to access, but Gordon added a consequence of this is the criminal drug trade has moved into harder and more dangerous drugs as a result.
It's shifted from being, you know, a marijuana trade to one that's more concerned with chemicals. And those things are much easier to move around. So fentanyl, for example, can be shipped much easier. Much more easily than is the case with marijuana, which is bulky.
The RCMP know drug activity is increasing in our community, but they have seen some success recently, including a drug bust earlier this month that seized more than 2 kilograms of cocaine and meth, and a separate drug bust which seized more than 10,000 pills alongside fentanyl, cocaine, and meth. Tommy Osborne, CKPG News.
Well, it's budget time, and the regional district of Fraser Ford George has passed their budget for 2024. The rural regions of the area are broken into seven regions and four municipalities. And the tax breakdown for each of them is different. It depends all on the services provided in each of the jurisdictions.
We have 92 of them. They're all separate, and you can't move money between them. And it depends based on an individual's assessment and what services they receive, what their actual tax requisition looks like. So for the regional district, we have regional-wide services. Everybody pays for those, including people who live within the municipal boundaries. We have rural services, and only the rural folks pay for those. And then we have local area services, such as a volunteer fire department or a water system, and only the people on those systems pay for those. So it really depends, like I say, what services you receive, what your personal home assessment is, what the taxation looks like.
It's that time of year again when the street sweepers are cleaning the gravel off the roads. And with the especially dry spring, it's good to be aware of the air you're breathing in. Sam Bennison has more on dust advisories on this week's To Your Health.
And now To Your Health. Brought to you by Hard Drugs, 3rd Avenue Pharmacy, and the Phoenix Pharmacy.
Dust. It's on the roads, in the air, and without precautions, in your lungs, which can cause respiratory damage. Dust can come from many places, but traction gravel on the streets is currently a significant source.
We've had a very dry spring. We've had a lot of advisories start early, and we've seen a number of advisories in Prince George as well as other communities in British Columbia. And so roadways are a big, big source of that.
Well, you can see the larger dust particles, the dust you can't see also has significant impacts.
We also monitor particles that are even smaller, 2.5 micrometers in diameter and smaller. And those typically originate from combustion sources. So you may see at other times we have what's called an air quality advisory issued in the city. And that's because of those finer particles. In terms of health implications, both can impact your health, but there are stronger associations with those finer particles.
Wearing a mask can prevent you from breathing in some dust particles when traveling near a road. However, it must be tight against your face in order for it to be effective.
With dust, you can generally see. It's often close to roadways with this type of source. So it's just a matter of trying to be aware of when you're out or how long you're out. If you're walking and you can avoid a busier roadway and go on a quieter roadway, for example, that's a great choice. The idea is really just to reduce exposure as much as you reasonably can.
You can help prevent air quality from worsening during this time of year by not idling your vehicle, using public transit, and taking precautions when cleaning your yard.
If people are out cleaning up their yards and there's dust down and it's really dry, it's great if you can just not use a huge amount of water, because we want to be water conscious as well, but wet things down so that we're not creating more dust if you're sweeping your driveway or that type of thing.
The BC Air Quality website has the latest air quality advisories. Sam Bennison, CKPG News.
To your health, brought to you by Hard Drugs, Third Avenue Pharmacy, and the Phoenix Pharmacy.
As of this morning, the lowest gas price in Prince George was sitting at $1.579 per liter at Costco. The lowest price in the province right now is in Salmon Arm at $1.516 per liter. Manitoba currently has the lowest fuel prices on average in the country at $1.392 per liter, while BC has an average price of $1.865 per liter.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads, paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
Well, it's the final CHL regular season rankings. They're out, and the Prince George Cougars have impressed so much in the final month of the year that they ended the year number one in the entire league. Capping off the regular season on a 19-game point streak, the longest active point streak in the CHL, the Cougars wrapped up the 2023-24 campaign with a mint record of 49-15-1-3. How about that? The best in team's history. The team has held on to the number one spot for the third week in a row and fourth week overall this season. They also finished the year with the CHL's best goal differential with a plus 129, while plenty of players broke personal franchise records, including Zach Funk, Riley Height, Hudson Thornton, Josh Ravensbergen, and Tarek Parasak. Combine that with the recent return of LA Kings prospect Cohen Zimmer to the lineup, and the Cougars hope this will be the year they earn a WHL championship and make their first trip to the Memorial Cup in franchise history.
Yeah, that's pretty special for our group, and I think that's something that we've kind of earned over time. We've put in a lot of work over the years that I've been here, and especially this year, and it's obviously showed off. We had such a special team this year with so many guys that did so many great things for us, and so many personal accolades and so many team accolades, and just to add that one for us is it's pretty special, and it's one that myself is going to remember for a long time.
It's playoff time for the Prince George Cougars. They begin this weekend. Anthony Correa is here to talk about the team and what to expect in a very exciting time. Now, Anthony, first of all, before we get there, There is a barbecue currently going on, their playoff barbecue. You were just down there. Can you tell me a little bit about the festivities? How are things down there? A lot of fans?
Yeah, a lot of fans. It's exciting stuff, all at the CN Center parking lot. It still is going on till 6:30, so maybe after the show you start watching. head on down there, get some free hot dogs, you get to meet the players, there's some Fanboni rides, you know, dressing room tours if you ask, and plenty of street hockey. So if you want to try and dangle Riley Height, you got the perfect opportunity. I don't know if he'll let it happen that easy. He's a pretty low-key guy, but yes, and exciting stuff, and you know, sale our tickets on sale for game 1 and 2 down there as well. So to festivities and a great way to kick off the playoff season, as we call it.
Now, I know heading down the stretch of this regular season, you were the biggest Portland Winterhawks fan in all the land there, but the Cougars ended up grabbing that number one seed, kind of improbably, actually, but it was a great performance down the stretch. Now, how does that bode well for the Cougars as we look towards the playoffs? They're going to have home ice for at least the first 3 rounds. And they start with a big matchup against Spokane.
Yeah, big matchup against Spokane. But, you know, we'll go back to just that last month of the season, that point streak. They did not lose a game in regulation, and that bodes well. This team is as hot as any team in the WHL right now. And, you know, Spokane, even though they did play them well, they might be in a little bit of trouble here, you know, especially getting Cohen Zeeman back into the lineup. You may have saw him at that final home opener, Kamloops. He was kind of getting his feet wet, and then near the end of the game, Mark Lamb was shifting him with Zach Funk, with Riley Height. So, you know, if he gets going, he still has another week to get his conditioning training up. And yeah, this team should be at full capacity, full power, and it should be a very exciting series between Spokane. A lot of high scoring on both sides. But, you know, I think give me the Cougars round one, hopefully.
Yeah, no, it should be exciting. Look at this. We got new graphics, Anthony Curio.
Yes, this
We're
is
excited.
Awesome.
The Cougars are in the playoffs. They're the number one seed. Can I get a prediction for the first round series?
Prediction for the first round series. That's a tough one. But I think Spokane will keep it close. I'm going to go with the Cougars in six. Cougars in six.
I'm saying Cougars in four. I think it's going to be a sweep.
Straight sweep. That would be the best case scenario, you
know?
Well,
you know, I know Spokane played the Cougars tough throughout the regular season, but like you said, Cohen Zeemer coming back.
Limit the travel.
I just think this team is really peaking at the right time here. So I'm going to go a clean sweep.
You know, to build on that quickly, peaking at the right time, I got to tell you guys, I'm going to be growing a playoff beard this year.
Oh, well, attempting to grow a playoff beard.
So, you know, fingers crossed they go on a long run, or Spruce Kings, you know, both playoff hockey teams.
Right?
But yeah, you know, I will grow this out. I will not shave it until the Cougars or Spruce Kings lose. So we'll see how, you know, awesome this gets. I did it a little bit last year and, you know, lasted to the second round, but hopefully.
Well, you're also, you're a year older now, Anthony Curia. Hopefully it'll work out better this
time. Yeah, right.
I think I can speak for all of Prince George when I say we're definitely looking forward to
seeing
that beautiful face with a beard. All right, Anthony, thank you very much for that. We look forward to the first round.
The TSX is down 30 points to close at 21,913. The Dow Jones is down 31 points to close at 39,282. And Artemis Gold went up 13 cents to close at $7.98.
Good evening again. We're looking at a pretty nice start to our Wednesday. We'll get to that in a moment, but taking you back from earlier today, it actually turned out to be a lovely afternoon, mix of sun and cloud for the most part. So again, we still have that break right about here for tomorrow before this system out here really starts to move in. So that'll increase the clouds through the afternoon tomorrow, and then we'll have some showers developing, changing over to rain on Wednesday night, and actually even shifting into periods of snow for Thursday. So it's quite a blast of precipitation just right before we get that nice clearing for the long weekend. The Easter weekend looks pretty good going forward as we have a ridge building. So here's our future cast. You can see quite an eventful going into tonight and tomorrow for the early half. And then we start to see an increase in clouds right about there in the afternoon. Showers developing, switching over to rain, and even, yes, some periods of snow or flurries at times as well. So most of this system is really packing a punch along the coast, but certainly, and that's up and down the coast, but it is going to still make its way towards us. So creating some a little bit of a disturbance into our midweek weather forecast. And then come Friday, it's the start of a nice ridge that builds. 4 degrees, Fort St. John tomorrow. You've cooled down from those really above average temperatures the last few days. Some cloudier skies as well. We'll sit at about 10. We've got showers through the afternoon possible. Better chance though through the evening hours with rain developing. 10 in Kamloops, mainly cloudy skies as well. And quite wet along the south coast, right up and down around most of the coast going forward into especially tomorrow evening. 9 in Burns Lake tomorrow, you'll see some sunshine to start the day. 10 in Vanderhoof as well. And again, we have mainly sunny skies to start our day. It's through the afternoon that the shift happens. So get out in the morning if you can. 8 in Mackenzie and still quite mild down through Quesnel as well. It'll be a wet one along the west coast. 10 degrees Vancouver, clouds and showers expected. 10 in Edmonton and looking at a really nice afternoon actually. Plus 1 in Regina with mainly sunny skies and then cloudier as we go through Winnipeg down through Toronto looking good. So the eastern half of the country actually picking up some nice temperatures for the day tomorrow. So it is a mixed bag of weather just because we do have showers, possible snow, and then some really nice sunshine after that. So it's kind of a little unsettled as we move towards the Easter long weekend, but pretty confident that we should see some fairly decent weather for the Easter weekend. And there it is there for Burns Lake. So 10 degrees Saturday for you. Minus 9 tonight, clear skies up to 9 tomorrow with an increase in cloud, but starting the day off nice and sunny. Clear tonight in Mackenzie. That will carry into most of your Wednesday, and actually not a lot of precipitation anticipated for Mackenzie, although temperatures will dip down just a little bit on Thursday to plus 2. Still some sunshine possible, though. McBride, minus 2 tonight with partly cloudy skies. You've got morning showers possible tomorrow, and then a bit of snow Thursday and actually even into Friday morning. Temperatures only plus 4, but into the weekend, Saturday, Sunday, and Easter Monday looking really nice. Back to those double digits. Quesnel, minus 3 tonight. Clear, partly cloudy overnight. Passing afternoon showers are possible, but still a high of 12 tomorrow, and then that's about it. Look at that. 17 degrees on Easter Sunday, 21 potentially on Easter Monday. Going to be a really, really nice weather weekend for everybody getting out and about for an Easter egg hunt. And the same goes for us. Look at that. Easter Sunday, 15 degrees. So certainly not quite as cool, but yes, a little unsettled. And yeah, we could see some of that white stuff falling on Thursday.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
It's a big night for the UNBC Timberwolves Student Athlete Society as they're hosting the MVP of the Month co-ed dodgeball tournament. Everything takes place at the Northern Sports Center with 26 teams set to square off tonight. A $500 cash prize is up for grabs in this exciting tournament. It's the second time the Student Athlete Society has hosted a fundraiser this year, opening up to the community to sign up as well. All the funds raised by the teams will go towards Grace Calhoun, this year's MVP of the month. And it caps off a great fundraising effort by the TSAS.
Grace is an amazing person, and you know, her and her family really are super appreciative of everything we've done, and we honestly couldn't have chose better people to help out, and we're just so excited and happy to be helpful towards her, and we're so appreciative of the community behind our back as well. It was obviously very lighthearted. Everyone has a lot of fun. There's so many teams, so many different people. We got Timberwolves. This year we actually opened it up to the whole community, so it's not just UNBC students, but it's anyone and everyone. So hopefully we got lots of different demographics and lots of donations coming in, and it should be really fun.
It's time for an update on the Canadian wheelchair rugby team, which participated in the Paralympic qualifiers tournament in New Zealand this past weekend. And why are we giving an update on them? Well, here's why. Prince George's very own Joel Ewart is playing on Team Canada and has helped them qualify for the 2024 Paralympic Games in Paris. After a great round robin tournament for the Canadians, they beat Germany in the semis to secure their spot in the games. Unfortunately for Ewart and his teammates, they fell in the finals to Team Australia in a nail biter, with the final in that one being 49-48. Still, despite the loss, Team Canada's wheelchair rugby team is off to France to compete this summer. The Canucks played in one of just two NHL games last night as they took on the LA Kings, so why not do a Canucks-themed CKP3? It's all here with Anthony Correa.
Starting with LA opening the scoring.
Dubois in on the right wing. P.L. Dubois coming towards the goal, centers the puck, they score! Fiala put it home on the centering pass from Dubois, and the Kings open the scoring 7:01 into the first.
It's a bad line change for Vancouver. If you count, you can only see four Canucks players on the ice, and LA takes a lead. Vancouver responds in the period, though.
Time up with the big club. Here's Lafferty. Power move in front. Gets right in. Scores! Great shot for this line. And Lafferty ties his career high.
Sam Lafferty with the nicest goal in this countdown as he drives to the net with some nifty moves. Unfortunately for Vancouver, skill points don't win hockey games as Kopitar continues to dominate.
Drew Doughty leaves Ramsey Kopitar. Wrist shot, glove save, knocked down, loose puck. Kick to the side, put in by Kopitar. Canucks just couldn't find the puck to get it out of danger. And Kopitar came from behind the net to put it in on the backhand and give LA a 3-1 lead. Quinn Hughes slow to get up, and he's a little shaken up.
36 years old, but it doesn't matter. He always finds a way to impact the game. That goal putting him 50th on the NHL all-time point list as the Canucks drop this one 3-2 and Kopitar takes top spot in tonight's CKP3.
Hello from the CKPG Today side. Got a great one coming up over here, including your introduction to the Champions of Magic. Yeah, pair performers going to hit the stage here on April the 7th coming up at CN Center. Yeah. Going to meet a pair of them, give you the code word on the show today too, so you can enter online and win a 4-pack of tickets to see the Champions of Magic, plus so much more over on this side of the studio. Might even be a little magical. What's not magical right now is the pothole situation. You on the other side, boy, they're hard to dodge these days. You hit any? I definitely have.
No ball clean on that front, Caden, but that's some troubling news. I hope that your Porsche 911 gets back on the Prince George roads anytime now. It's a tough life being that Today Show anchor, I tell you, folks. That's all for now, folks. Thanks so much for joining us, as always. Your last look tonight is some nice architecture over at UNBC. Have yourselves a great night, and if you see that Porsche on the side of the road, help the kid out. Have a good night, folks.